treasurer, do you not want to get a call at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on Monday, where's their check? There's a procedure for reporting paperwork, and the paperwork in on time, so we can have checks. If they don't come in at the right time, that's...
Next month.
That's next month. Now, we recognize there's a holiday season coming up, and we'd like to implement this, but we don't want to hold our things without written documentation, and I think the attorney is going out of his way to be generous to try and give us something to work with. That's what you're going to be discussing right now, voting on. Okay, discussion.
To clarify, the effect of this motion to reconsider as it will be as if this motion had not been passed. Then, what we'll have to make a new motion to, it will be as if the motion from September 19th had not been approved. Then a new motion will need to be made, adopting a motion to approve the resolution, approving the intergovernmental agreement in amended form. So the first motion is the motion to reconsider. You should vote on that first.
Well, I'd like to make that motion.
Well, so who made that motion? Rita made the motion. Keith second. Roll call, please.
Sams.
E. Twix. We'll get back to him.
Denny.
Yes.
Thompson.
Yes.
Olson.
Yes.
Finley.
Yes.
Sams. Sorry.
Yes.
Sams said yes.
So the next motion would be a motion to adopt the resolution approving the proposed intergovernmental agreement in the form of the draft you have dated 10/14/11.
I would like to make that motion.
Second.
Roll call.
Olson?
Yes.
Finley?
Yes.
Denny?
Yes.
Thompson? Sams? Sorry.
Yes.
All yeses. Okay. That concludes your activities. I think we should all thank the attorney for going on his way on this particular deal, because you just can't have people that bring things to the village. You have to bring them up at the right time for them. And if their attorney doesn't want to help, that's a problem. He's out. Okay. First item I have is well monitoring presentation by Baycock. You saw it.
Excuse me, please. Can I be recognized by the board, Mr. Watson?
No.
Attorney, specifically, I don't need to issue.
No, not right now. I have the floor.
Okay, well, I'm asking to be recognized.
I'm not recognizing right now.
When will you recognize the village of Deer Park residents?
We have recognized those earlier this evening in public comments.
I understand that, but my issue is when you find it on the newspaper already that we terminated our hearing, but then both and we didn't hear tonight. I think the horse was in front of the cargo behind the car that's not lined up right.
Okay. Where do you have that policy for the newspaper?
It's right here, it's stated 6:30.
Let's see.
It says right here, another village board. Your park president Cummins says whether this water protects and serves the village's residents for the citizens.
Let's see the
article. Right here, titled the Daily Herald.
Let me see the article.
Oh, that's not something that's reading the Herald.
No, let's see the article.
Number one. Number two.
Can I have your name, sir?
Yes. Ms. Abbott? T-O-C-Z-Y-S-K-I. 20709 Wallinger.
Okay.
We'll put it up to sale tomorrow. You're putting Lake County in back in here where they don't even know they own a piece of Lake County in the street here. And they're doing the whole rest of it. Maybe we'll find the dimensions.
First of all, let's stop right now.
If you put more officers in equipment.
Wait, sir.
You're adding to the problems we already have in this country. You know what, you guys just.
No, first of all,
I appreciate it that much.
No, no, no.
But that was at 6:30 today.
No, wait, let me speak.
I don't know if the time's running out, but it's at 6:30 today that that came out into the.
Wait, let me just say this much. I never made these comments, these erroneous comments.
Well, that's what you can say right there. That's what you can say, you can back the law you want.
No, I'm telling you right now, I never made these comments, I have not discussed this with the press.
Then he's got to take a legal action for going to.
He might, and we appreciate that.
I love this here.
Well, I think.
We can't even work with anybody.
I think it's important to recognize the fact that the agenda for this meeting was posted on the village's website on Friday.
No, like last night.
Whenever it was posted, it was downloaded to the, or uploaded to the village's website. When was that, Elizabeth?
Kate, actually. She had problems.
Yeah.
That's a erroneous argument, I haven't talked to, wait, let me finish. You're speaking like I want to speak. Number one is, this village will not compromise its police protection. You've been advised of that on 3 different occasions. Two is, that is erroneous comment. That comment there is a direct result of the Herald. Those comments in there, I never made.
They are not quotes. I'm sorry to speak up like this, but they're actually just taken out of the letter. They are not comments made.
He said they were quoted.
It's not quoted. If you read the article, it says.
He made the comment they were quotations. And the comments I made.
I didn't say quotations, I said.
They're not quotations.
You said quotations, I made them.
I read Mayor Kellerman said, this is what Mayor Kellerman said.
In the letter, it says in the letter.
Okay.
It's from the letter.
But your letter to the other town was on the board, I was posted on the website, right? I don't know if you wanted that there, but it doesn't make you look real good.
Just to clarify.
So that's what she's got.
Everything that was in the article is taken out of the letter, and it's mentioned in the article that it's out of the letter, never once does it say that you were quoted.
I think you posted too much stuff on the website. Deer Park website, you got too much stuff on it.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
Too much stuff?
We've got his letter going over to Phil Beer, saying terminate the agreement, date tomorrow. Why would you?
Well, this is.
Why would you do that to me?
What was on the agenda?
Because it's a public forum, and you're required to.
Excuse me, public forum, it means you inform the people.
First minute.
You don't slide the meeting on Sunday night. You don't slide the prior meeting that you had executive session on a special meeting and just put a post-it note basically in the window downstairs on Monday back 2 months ago.
Okay.
You don't do that stuff. You folks recognize you for being in charge right now, but God help us all to turn this whole thing over and get new staff in here, because you know what? My understanding is, on a personal note, that you wanted Phil Beer out, that you can't get along with Phil Beer. Now, that's a personal note, sir. I can't justify it. I'm trying to go back in the air, sir.
Sir.
Okay.
You're through the right now. If you want, I'll call Phil Beer up and ask him to remove him from the building.
I'm sorry, you what?
I have the floor. This is a village meeting. We're conducted in a village manner. This I like. You want that back? You got it back.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Watch your homes. You gotta be careful now. We're not really.
Sir, thank you.
That's a problem.
Thank you.
And Jim, thanks for no help. You told me different in your driveway.
Sir, thank you. Okay. Now, well monitoring the project cost $4,000. Due to the buoyancy of the meeting tonight, we're going to table that, because I think it's a good project we should have, because that way we're tuned in with a group of people monitoring the water levels. We could determine what the water level will be here, so if our pumps have to go down 115 feet or something like that, they'll tell us. The Bay Camp dinner costs $39. I would like a motion here. Go talk to your spouses, get back. It's a good dinner. And by that I mean is you meet people in other situations such as you're in. Keith will tell you this, Dale will tell you this. And it's really where you get the government community starts to cooperate. For example, South Elgin with the generator. You know. Or it could be snow plowing the Cuban Township. You know, things just work, and I think you really need to meet other people, because when you meet other people, you're going to find out that what what is happening is not unique in this village, it's happening in all the villages. Might be a different subject here or there, but it's happening in all. So I encourage everybody to go there. I think the, it's, I don't know what the page is, we have to define it, but give a call into Jim.
We got invitations.
You got invitations?
Yeah.
Okay. I think we should make a motion that the village pay for that. What do you want?
Well, I'll make that motion, I'm not gonna be able to make the dinner, so I'm a little less.
They would apply to the trustees, the president, and Dave Heineke and his wife. Dave Heineke was on the Klein nomination or revival committee, so he got an invitation also. But I think you would enjoy that, it'd be a good dinner. We got a motion, give a second. Bill wants a second? Roll call.
What is the motion for?
To the village to pay $39 for yourself and another $39 for your wife to attend the Big Cock dinner. To meet all the celebrities in the Big Cock community.
Well, I'm gonna share it, Bill, no good ideas.
Oh, it's a good idea for him, yes.
I'm not sure.
No, but if you can, I mean, just throw that one out. In total, it'd be about $546. Okay, roll call.
Ready?
Yes.
Allison?
No.
Wilson?
Yes.
Sands?
He's checked out.
Oh, okay.
His minutes ran out.
Finley?
Yes.
Sarnick?
Yes.
That carries. Okay, we've read the village treasurer appointment. Now, the VE Farm Committee, I've given this some deep thought. I'd like to appoint Rita Finley as chairman. On that committee also would be Keith Olson, Kathy Cotter, and Maggie Gulledge. I have one accountant with three marketing people. And we've got two new fresh views from the outside looking into this to come up with maybe what guidelines we want to. And just to get a fresh look as far as the individual citizens, what their perspective is. I think these two people would be good. Secondly, I think that we should give Rita the opportunity if she was to find another person in the community or wanted to expand it, to just have them join the committee. There's no really formal requirements for it.
One objectivity.
Pardon me?
One objectivity.
One objectivity.
Objectivity.
And the parameters that we want set up. For example, what is our break if we wanted, number one, we have to decide if we want to do it. Secondly, what the cost will be. And what's our break even points in there? Okay. Do I have a motion to accept those names?
Can I just ask you to spell your last name, Stanley?
C-O-T-H-E-R?
C-O-T-T-E-R.
T-T?
Okay, and the other person?
Gulledge, G-U-L-L-E-D-G-E. Does that sound right?
I'll say that again, G-U-L-L-E-D-G.
I do have a question for Trustee Finley and Trustee Olson. I know you're both on the tourism committee together, and maybe directed more at Trustee Olson if he's gonna be spread too thin. Are you in favor of being on this committee, Keith?
Well, yes. I don't anticipate that this committee is going to have an extensive period of meetings, and it does tie in fairly closely with the activities of the tourism committee. But if you would rather be on there, Alan, that's okay.
Oh, no, I'm not going there, Keith. I don't understand why there needs to be two trustees, and
really
I just know that sometimes people are spread thin. So I just was raising the question.
You want me to help you on?
That's all I was saying. I wasn't looking for any particular result.
Well, because you're the trustee in charge of making
the council. That was the reason for us. That was the justification.
This is gonna be kind of a short-term committee.
It's a short-term, and it's really to get some parameters set up. That's right. Okay. Roll call.
Question. Is that gonna require public notice of agenda?
We're gonna do that right now with the two trustees, rather than three trustees, we may not have to go through the formal procedure.
Well, actually, you still would.
Yeah.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, you don't base the determination of Open Meetings Act compliance based on just the number of trustees, but how many, once it's a committee, the committee has to comply with the Open Meetings Act, just like the board does. So if the committee has five members, then, you know, a meeting of three members in that case constitutes a quorum. So it, the Open Meeting Act compliance is necessary, but it's not really burdensome. I mean, it's very simple to post an agenda and notice 48 hours in advance.
Okay. Roll call, please. We have a second.
Oh.
We read it, then. Alan won't make the motion, I think Keith seconded. Did you?
No.
Yeah, I don't get anything.
Oh, did anybody make the motion to approve the appointments?
Does it make sense to have a committee? I'm just thinking, we're just trying to meet a few meetings.
That's right.
We need to have a formal meeting, you know, just trying to be efficient. I don't want the person's like a meeting, we need like an hour a day, every couple of, you know.
Let's table that right now, we'll go forward, if no one wants to make a motion, let's table.
I'll make the motion.
Give me a second. Well, that's one of me, and I said about 10 seconds. Okay. On the other side of it, I'd like to bring up two things. Pans of Bread is going to have an open house on the October the 22nd, I believe it's 9 o'clock. Also, I don't know if you had a chance to go to Red Robin, that looked pretty good too. Red Robin really started to do a good job there. So things look good in the village. And with that comment, I'm going to turn it over to the trustee who's going to give us a what we want on sales tax.
As I checked as of today, and it hasn't come in yet. We haven't been paid. And historically, the state doesn't pay that until around the 20th or so. So in meetings past, it comes in like that day or day before or something like that. So we've got an early meeting here. We haven't received the money yet. I have nothing to report. I'm hoping to get a little bit ahead of the budget with this, so I was looking to report, but I can't yet.
Thank you. Joel, you're up.
I am on page 127. There's
127.
There's four items. Most of which probably don't need a lot of publishing. The first item is the art inventory, which I think
consider putting money at, putting money towards on preventative maintenance, absolutely.
So we invite him for a 10-15 minute presentation or something.
This would be a good idea now, one more step further. Jim?
Yes, sir.
This applies, we've got the problem with the trees. One reason we selected the people who Joel recommended is their professionalism, they have software. So we can come up with a presentation, they can go on with this audit like you're saying. We could forecast what our tree requirements may be for next year, like Alan suggested. Now.
Okay, well, I'll ask them to come out.
Because they have the software to do it, so we need it.
Trustee Thomason, will they look at trees on private property?
Sure.
With, I mean, with, as part of the scope of services, with the idea that an ash tree on private property could be infected and infect other trees that are on public property?
For $6.50, they'll go anywhere.
No, let me just put on one thing. Prior to you coming on board, I mean, we have this analysis at Baycock, just in the right of way, you could be talking $100,000. If you go to private property, you're talking the bill goes up to about $500,000. So you have to watch what comments you make on it.
Yeah.
It escalates very dramatically. The point, the place is going.
Well, that's what I'm asking.
It's a very dramatic escalation.
So the answer is no.
Realistically, it could be.
Well, if we can get some type of recommendation, residents.
The residents could contact them through the village.
Right, because some other towns have done.
Yes,
so
that's
recommended
what
a couple suppliers.
Yes.
Maybe get a better rate or something.
Well, I don't know. The villages are recommending because they realize that if you take one house, could have 100 trees. There's some heavily wooded areas in the village.
We could at least make people aware.
They could be aware, they contract that individually with their own home, yeah.
The second item, the soccer field, if you recall, this is before my time, we entered into a long-term agreement with Eagle Soccer to give them priority for two soccer fields. They had 2 years in which to create improvements, which they have started actually last week, and they dumped dirt today, I understand, to improve without encroaching the wetlands, two soccer fields over at the town center. So the goal is the fields ready.
Lake Zurich, the fields that are done by Lake Zurich Baseball are maintained by Lake Zurich Baseball. Park district nor the city pays for that maintenance. The problem that happened is Barrington and Lake Zurich were using it. They already used it to grade it. If something happened and the fields were not graded the next day for the next people, that's where the conflict came.
If we were to get a second ball field, how many days a week would Barrington be? Because that would make it, then you'd have like 14 days on the field.
Well, Barrington Competitive had made a gentleman's offer to build a second field.
Right.
But I've since gotten more information from Todd about what that first field cost. And if you call out all of the infrastructure stuff that they also had to do, that probably wouldn't be necessary. You're talking about $200,000.
Is that over their budget?
I don't know.
Okay.
When we talked with them before, I was something threw up the number $100,000. But that's really one of the issues on the table, is to find out if either or any of these people are willing to actually invest, or maybe go in together.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought maybe split the cost, and then they I think they all said they wanted long-term agreements if they're going to put money into it. So I thought that maybe be a plausible thing, is they have some sort of share, and then build out that second field.
Well, Lake Zurich's not wanting to invest, you're saying?
They just looked and said, well, maybe. But I think that they were really playing the cards that they have 100 of our kids, Deer Park kids in the program, and therefore we should be good neighbors. They were really nice. I really liked them. They were really good guys. But I think their first pitch was, pun intended, that they are part of us, and therefore can we just share the fields.
If you talk to the gentleman in charge of Lake Zurich Baseball and Lake Zurich Park,
no.
Give him a call. Is
there
just, I don't know what it is.
You mean the guy in charge of LCBSA or in charge of the park district?
Parker, sir. They'll fill in right away. I mean, they'll be very long. They'll just tell you what they said.
Okay.
If there'd be two advantages if we were to be able to have Lake Zurich Baseball within Deer Park. One is the residents that have their kids in Lake Zurich Baseball won't have to drive as far to some of the fields. And the second is they get the in-district rates. It's not a huge difference in price, but you get a sense. A lot of people are upset when we leave the industry. It's only like $25. You know, they have 100 children. It's only $2,500 a year that they're making in our district. Not that much, but if they couldn't hold games here right away, if they could use our fields for tournaments or something, and that in exchange for that, we can get in-district rates. That would be a benefit to the residents.
The problem you have, Joel's getting into it right now, we should maybe table this for the next time, is BCBC is an honorable group. They maintain what they're going to do. They still have to come up with an accounting for us. The other group in Barrington did not do that.
So they're just paying
the
rent.
Did they actually pay the rent? Because one of the things that came out is that, as a subsequent is that we got calls from Barrington School District 220 saying that Deer Park was making so much money running their ball fields that School District 220 should start doing that. And that was because this one group that doesn't want to pay anybody any money said that they should get the ball diamonds free. In other words, this group was playing School District 220, you know what I mean, in the Park District to make them look foolish. And you might want to call Barrington Partnership, they'll tell you how these groups move. Norm is not good. Lake Zurich is good. And maybe to come up with a joint venture with Lake Zurich would be a very good idea.
Jim, if Barrington is paid,
they decided to rent rather than do the
been hearing they say that they think building out a second quad field is a bad idea.
Some residents might.
Some residents?
They, well, I mean, they own a lot of open spaces, and they might view it as spending up less open space, even though that's an area that's, would actually bring more people to the town center.
It's a swamp.
Yes.
It's a swamp.
Yeah, well, it's not, some people want open spaces, not necessarily to run around, just look at open spaces. And, but I mean, I understand, it makes logical sense, it's not near a lot of residential areas, near town center, it brings people to the town center, and it allows more people to play baseball.
The problem you have with the second field, you got the, remember those diagrams I sent you?
It fits.
It fits?
Yeah.
If it fits, we don't have a problem, otherwise I'm a corporate engineer, this guy can follow.
We walked the field, Jim and I walked the field with Todd.
If it fits, okay.
Wanted that wildlife.
It was 200 foot.
A 200 foot field.
Okay, it fits, as long as it fits.
Yeah. Okay, the, our next item is sort of an odd thing, something before my time, but there was an invoice for services for cutting down trees from another contractor, who we had on our books, I guess, a couple of times for $7,750. And we never paid him because he didn't turn it into the nine. But he's actually one of the guys that bid on this current tree inventory. Jim brought it to my attention that the money was still outstanding. So he did submit his W-9 to me. So the question is, do we want to pay him?
You have to give that to the treasurer, village treasurer, the W-9.
I think she has it already. Well, the old one did. But I can be sent it to the board.
No, we don't have to get that, we have to do it the right way. Realistically, Jim will tell you that he has no idea what we're talking about here. And quite frankly, this is beyond, this is before my time too. This poor guy went and did the work and no payment.
Well, we never paid him because he never submitted it. If you recall, trustee Kaiser brought it up again. The offer was there, I know I made repetitive phone calls, and he didn't respond. And I think Joel's latest contact, he finally did come in with the W-9.
We finally got the paperwork for that.
Sorry.
We finally got the paperwork and set up right.
That's right.
And Joel should give credit for that. This one word, please help $7,500.
Must not be important to him.
Well, I can just tell you, we called him many times to get this stuff in.
We want to pay your bill.
We want to pay your bill.
We're trying to pay you, we're trying to.
Yeah.
It's amazing how many small contractors of any type of contractor, they're good at what they do and they're terrible business people. And I asked him, I said, don't you want the money? And he said, oh yeah, it's been on my list. But it's, you know, years old, so it's the right thing to do to pay him.
Well, if it's been submitted for payment and Administrator Connors has approved it, it will be paid.
Well, the question is, and I know time's going, the question is that this will appear in this budget, which has been budgeted for. If you acknowledge that, we will process it.
Yeah.
And until he recently came into the W-9, we couldn't. So he has that now. We'll put this in the AP list for next month. But
well, it's going to be charged against your budget this year, Joel, but that's the way it goes.
Yes. You're right, sir. I know. It's still the right thing to do. Jim said that he did very good work.
Yeah.
All right. Okay. The last thing is just the list. You know, I got the list of open items. We're actually making still good progress on it. Two or three of the items that are still listed, which have been paid 143.
two go out, they went to the Boy Scouts, and these are kids, and they promised the moon, they waste a lot of time, and this is what happens, you know, it's more.
Well, when the Boy Scouts are working on Eagle Scout projects, you typically get an email, like, so-and-so is working on this Eagle Scout project, and you try to solicit helpers, I've seen nothing on this.
No, but that's what I'm trying to say, the kids have good intentions.
Not from you, I'm talking about from within the.
They're just kids, and Jim and Joe have a lot of patience just to try and deal with these kids.
Right, what I'm saying is, there hasn't, I don't see him bringing a lot of this child, this guy forward, within the troop, like, I don't see the communications. Usually when the Boy Scouts are working on a project, for example, one of the Eagle Scout projects was they created this cabinet for Lakeser Fire Police Department to display these items for fire department, and there was this big coordinated event where they solicited help from other Boy Scouts, and this whole series of things to do, I haven't seen that with this, so I don't know who's, I don't know who.
If I didn't start over again, I would, the first meeting would have been with his council. That's why.
I agree.
Alex stopped by tonight, for additional paperwork, I think the holdup is his advisor giving him the final go-ahead.
Okay.
Mr. L. something. So, he's waiting for that, he wants to get started.
What is his name again?
Alex Schwartz.
Alex Schwartz.
Alex.
I did ask him, he was gonna make solicitations to people in Deer Park along the parkways for money, and I said no. I didn't feel comfortable that we're gonna go and ask residents to pay for things that he's doing. I understand he's gotta raise money, I just thought it was a little presumptuous.
How much does he have to raise, does he know?
I don't know.
Okay.
But Jim Denny, trustee Denny, you did remember that you wanted to support him, so wanted to know whether he can still ask you.
When he gets his projects done, Rich.
He was talking about $1,000.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all I.
So what is it that you want from him right now?
Nothing, just not to say, just leave it alone. I think he's.
So you don't want me to?
No.
Okay.
I think he's okay.
Okay.
But just be patient with him, since they're on this list.
Okay.
Excuse me, just a moment, do we need a motion, to get invoice?
It'll be on the next list.
Oh, it'll be on there, okay.
Okay, I noticed that one lady in the back has been very patient, Keith, you're gonna get pushed aside. Would the great lady like to come up? Maybe she's got great for us, if she doesn't, we have another tree here.
Under my purple, she is. This is for Keith, right? Had a contract last year where she uses the Baby Barnes commercial kitchen for her enterprise, great. It expired in September, and I believe she's looking for its renewal. She has access to the barn through the lock key system she comes in. We have not had one issue whatsoever. I guess the business is growing.
It's growing, and we are working, we know we're back in our business, so, yeah, it's growing.
Well, I'd like to move that we.
I just have to be here, do the fees pay the fees she's paying, pay the expenses?
She does, you just say, please.
She doesn't really use any. She uses the kitchen, cleans it up, she doesn't use any utilities.
Water.
Yeah, we don't.
But it is $15 a month, or $15 an hour, which strikes me as a little way low. Would you be willing to pay more? I have trouble, I wish you the best of luck in your business, and I love entrepreneurs and rugged individualism, all about that. But I can't support the expenditure of village resources at cold and chill you out here. I just think it's worth more than that, and there is some wear and tear on the property, and you do have the exclusivity for the period of time that you're here. And I just can't support $15 an hour for village resources. I would like to say yes to something, but I can't say yes to $15 an hour. And I don't really want to get into a negotiation here, and this isn't the time or the place, but I'm going to vote no against this unless you're willing to come forward with something right away. And I would urge my fellow trustees to vote no on this. And that's not to say that, you know, I don't like you as an individual, and I know you're a resident. I note that point very well. And I know you've done it in the past, but, you know, it's been $15 in the past, too. So I'd like for you to volunteer to come forth with just amending this agreement for something substantially more than $15 an hour so that I can vote for this. See, that's just not right. And it's part of the whole problem that I brought up at last month's meeting, if you were here for last month, where the village is taking significant shortages on the rental of the barn. And we're willing, as we said last month and reiterate again this month, we're willing to consider arrangements to rent the barn. But I'm not willing to consider exclusive ability to use the barn at $15 an hour, which is what you have. So this kind of thing is what we've got to improve for the benefit of our citizens, for the village resources.
When you say exclusive, are you referring to the only person who's in the kitchen?
Yes. Well, we're not in the business of operating kitchen facilities. So, you know, back to you and what you're doing in this contract, and it's 10:15 in the evening. I'm going to urge my fellow board members to vote no on this. Now, they have their own votes, and they've heard enough out of me. But we as a village have to do better than this, is my perspective.
Jim, for your perspective, I just happen to see this. The museum space runs for 20 hours per hour.
Well, hey, I can't point to